Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
What's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. Early Saturday morning. I'm a little bit, it's been a rough morning for me. Had a crazy crisis yesterday, but everything is great and with the family and everything. I know you guys want to get to this video and to this guest. If you guys have watched this channel before, you've seen my video on the Bully Kutta. I was the person who presented the breed to us was Aaron Evans out of Colorado, and he's here today. He's going to talk to you guys about the breed. I'm going to ask him some questions right up front. We're going to kind of walk through the breed in America, and then we're going to open up the lines, and you guys can call in and ask your questions directly to Mr. Evans. All right, let me bring him in right now. What's going on, man?
Hey, how you doing? What's going on, Zeke?
I'm excellent, man. How you doing?
I'm cool. Every day above ground is a good one.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, you're getting this in that screen for me.
There you go. There we go. All right, there we go. Let's see.
All right, so we did a video maybe a couple of years ago now, right? A little over a year, because I didn't do anything in 2020. I didn't do anything in 2020.
About 2 years ago.
Very successful for the channel. A lot of people love the video. A lot of people still commenting on the video. Do you want to get that window?
Yeah.
But and the video was not without some controversy. You know, a lot of people. One of the biggest controversies was the naming, but we're gonna get to that later. I want you to be able to address that, the naming of your dogs. But let's start from the beginning, and let's start with the foundation. Let's tell everybody what exactly is the Bully Kutta.
The Bully Kutta is a mastiff breed that derives from India as well as Pakistan. The breed, and of course I have documented photographs with the National History Museum of Pakistan. The breed has been around well over 200 years. Mm-hmm. 200 years ago, India did not exist. It was British India. And Pakistan did not exist. It was British India. But now, in the present day time, Pakistan unequivocally exists. And the breed comes from Pakistan. And the breed also comes from India. India is no longer, British India no longer exists. The country of India was founded in 1947, as well as the country of Pakistan. Right. So the breed comes from both parts of the Punjab area in India as well as Pakistan. Right. And you can get good specimens from both areas, period.
Okay.
The specimens that I have, thanks to God and God alone, they are more of the authentic looking specimens. Originally, these dogs were not as tall as they are now. And once again, it provided anyone can show photograph documents. And of course, we'll need to see the pixels on the back of the photograph to see that they're from the 1890s, 1901, before 1947, when British and Pakistan were established. India and Pakistan were established. I apologize. So, you know, it's a lot of controversy around the history of these dogs. But unequivocally, right, the breed is over 500 years old. And you did have British breeds of dogs that were in that area with the British soldiers that were bred with the original Bully Kutta.
Right.
Okay.
All right, very cool.
You said something in regard to the name.
Well, no, I want to get to that later down the line. So one of the things that I think that you're probably your specialty is importing these dogs into America, sourcing out good specimens, and getting them into America. Can you just go ahead and explain that process for the audience?
Yes. There are two breeders that I would actually recommend, one in India one in Pakistan. The reason I would recommend them is because they have a general presence in their mentality of ethics and honesty. Okay. Unfortunately, in India as well as Pakistan, there are some breeders that will blatantly steal your money. They'll send you nothing. The dog that was actually in the documentary when you came out to our state and Bilal, I had to end up putting him to sleep because he had severe east-west back feet, which was a clear indicator of hip dysplasia because of the height of this breed. The breeder, Mohan Kumar in India, who is where I purchased the dogs from, he's replacing Bilal as we speak. He's actually replacing Bilal with two dogs, two puppies, God willing. There is a another breeder in Pakistan, Aziz Sarmid. He's a very reputable, honest breeder as well. He will not steal your money. He's working on his doctorate degree in Europe right now, Great Britain. But his family still lives and they breed horses in Pakistan. So bringing them in, of course, you know, the major hurdle when you're bringing these dogs into the country is first making sure that they meet all of the veterinarian prerequisites in regard to not bringing in any form of the pathogens, to make sure that they're healthy when they leave there. And that's why there's only three breeders with this breed. One here in America, two out of America, one in India, one in Pakistan, that I will even mention their name. Donald Stocks here in America, he has a good specimen, and he's a reputable breeder. Sarmid Aziz, like I said, in Pakistan, and Mohan Kumar, who is, he goes by the name of Sona Latival. He actually has a YouTube channel as well. He's the one I would recommend in India. Other than that, I want to put my name, which is attached to my wallet, behind any of those breeders in Pakistan or India. Because, unfortunately, they will rob you, man. Donald Stocks went through that.
Yeah.
And or they'll send you a dog that is not healthy.
Right.
And when you receive a puppy, like you saw Bilal, I love Bilal, but I had to put him down. Number one, he was a 33-inch tall puppy at 14 months. He had bad back hips, bad rear end. He was very, very dog and human aggressive, good protection dog. So I couldn't just give him to anybody, and he's a 33-inch tall puppy. Who wants a puppy that tall?
Right.
So I had some sort of emotional attachment to him, but I took him to the veterinarian at Colorado State University. And they said, look, his hips can't be repaired. The surgery wouldn't benefit him at all. So we recommend that he's going to be in a lot of pain. He's going to go through a lot of pain. So I put him to sleep.
Right. Well, that's
in the country, like I said, it's not that hard of a process. Originally, it was for me. Uh-huh. It definitely was for Donald Stocks, who was robbed for $9,000. But now we have solidified two ethical breeders, one in India, Mohan Kumar, and Aziz Sarmid in Pakistan. And now the problem, and then honestly, because the breed is here now, you know, I don't breed dogs for the profit, so I've only produced one litter. I'm in the process of producing another litter, but it's that'd be about a year or so just to replace the guarding stock I have on my property. Donald Stocks, that's a business for him, and he's going to do it ethically.
Right.
Period.
Right. I'm still trying to get to see Donald. I know he's a busy man, but he's in California, yeah. So I'm trying to make that trip. So the process, is it India? I don't know if you imported dogs from anywhere else in the world, but, you know, India, Pakistan, that's a different kind of place. Are there any extra hoops or any extra paperwork that has to get done to get those dogs here?
No, because the breeders on the ground over there that I recommend, they work with United Airlines and British Airways are the only two airlines they're bringing to America. I don't know about Emirates Airlines also brings into America, imports into America. So those two particular breeders work with the airline as well as the pet transporter over there. They stay to a price. Once again, the reason that I repetitively refer these three breeders was with Donald Stocks, you don't have to worry about importing it in. But with Sarmid and Mohan, they're gonna stay to a price. They're gonna state that you have a healthy dog, and they're gonna stand behind it.
We just lost light on your.
They jump through a lot of different hoops. They do.
Right. I just lost the light on your face, Aaron, real quick. I just lost the light on your face. What happened?
Can you see me now?
Yeah, you just got dark for a second. I thought there was there light in the room. On?
Can you see me now?
Yep.
Okay.
Let's see. All right.
So it's not really. I'm not going to say that it's an extremely difficult process. It's a time-taking process, and the main thing is the veterinarians on that end have to make sure that the dogs sit in quarantine for over 24 hours so that they're not bringing any foreign pathogens into America. And when you get them here, you have to understand that the airline's main emphasis is not to for the 24, 48 hours that they're actually en route here. Your dog is going to come here. The puppy's going to look a little malnourished. It is not. But I mean, 48 hours, they might get enough food for a cat, not for a dog. The airlines don't feed them and give them a lot of water. They, you know, like I said, they're transporting animals. And to be honest with you, because this breed, well-deserved, has such a aggressive stigma with it, an aggressive reputation, there are not a lot of airlines that will ship them in. When I was bringing in the Boers from Lucas Van Buren in South Africa in the mid-90s, it was relatively easy to bring them in. I mean, relatively easy. Now, because the Bully Kutta or the Pakistani Mastiff or the Indian Mastiff falls into that bully breed, that mastiff breed, a lot of them will tell you straight up. A lot of airlines will tell you straight up. Matter of fact, United actually has told me that they won't import it. And I'm not going to have the breeders in India or Pakistan. I'm not going to ask them to lie and say that this dog is a Great Dane or to say that it's another breed, because I'm just not going to ask anyone to lie, very point blank.
So obviously, you know, health is an issue with the breed, and getting a healthy specimen in the States can be a task. What is the general health of the breed of a healthy Bully Kutta? Let's just make the assumption that you get a good one.
They can endure the heat very well. They can endure the cold. Of course, you know, my dogs have their own dog house. They don't come in the home. Their health, I mean, threshold for pain is high. You get a healthy Bully Kutta, it's going to be a very, very dependable specimen to guard the outside. The only reference I cannot stand behind is whether they would be good for guarding livestock, because these dogs, their original purpose was for hunting. So therefore, you put them around maybe some sheep or goat, that instinct for them not to hunt is like trying to prevent a golden retriever's instinct not to retrieve. So in regard to the health, I have not, in the 4 years that I've owned my dogs, I've not had any real health problems, like with their skin, dermatic manes, which is something that's very prevalent in the Neapolitan Mastiffs. Other than the one hip issue with Bilal, I haven't had any health problems. because they're such a large and long and tall breed, when they get around 28 to 32, maybe 33 months, some of them, like the puppy that I have, Debo, from my only litter, they'll develop a callus on their elbows, because you have 150-pound plus dog consistently laying on their elbows, and even though they're laying on hay, they're still laying on a wooden house or a hard dirt floor. So they will get that growth on their elbow, but there is inflammation medicine that I obtained from my veterinarian, and I gave it to him, and the growth went away. He still has the calluses. Like, we have calluses on the bottom of our feet, we as humans, but the fluid buildup is gone.
Right.
Health-wise, these are some very strong, rustic dogs. And, you know, I'm praying and hoping to God that this breed doesn't fall victim to the breeding, the multi-breeding process of making the dog, of breeding the dog so much that you actually breed the rusticness out of the dog. Because remember, this breed of dog, India and Pakistan, some of those parts of those countries are not as modernized as I'm not going to say underdeveloped, because that's an offensive term and I would never use that. They're just not as modernized, and I don't use third world term either, because that's offensive. Mm-hmm. They're just not as modernized as certain parts of America. Actually, the certain parts of Pakistan and India are like where I live. You've been to my home. We got dirt road in front of my house. Right. The reason I'm bringing all that up is these dogs have a genetic adaptability where they can survive. I mean, and when I say they can survive, we had a hailstorm the other day, and as soon as the hailstorm stopped, the dogs come right outside to work. As long as they have shelter, which all dogs should have that humanity extended to them, as long as they have shelter, water, and food, as for foreign people coming up onto your property, that's why I sent you that video of that roofing gentleman who wanted to put the sleeve on with Brenda too.
Right.
And as you see in that video, she didn't just bite the sleeve. She's just trying to hunt the soft tissue on that man.
Right, right.
Are they trainable as a Doberman? Because, you know, Rottweilers, it would take a lot to you can put two male Dobermans, from what I've seen, two male Rottweilers around, and they're not going to fight. You put two male bully cutters around each other with the specimens that I have, or two females, they're going to establish pack order. And the only way they can do that is by fighting. So their trainability, I wouldn't say, is as good as the Rottweiler and the Doberman and other breeds that have been westernized. But for the surroundings that my wife and I have, for my profession, you can't come up on my acres without one of those dogs greeting you. That's all I want. Right. And they not going to greet you with no licks and want to be rubbed. They're going to bite you, period.
Right.
That's what I want.
Right.
So I still stand behind they're not very urbanized dogs. But some specimens are, but not the ones that I have. No.
Right.
And the health-wise, 10. Plain and simple.
Let's just deal with the working purpose of this breed. So obviously you said initially they were used for hunting. Give me 1 second. I just had an unexpected guest walk in the house. Hold on. In the room. Hold on. That's what happens when you don't teach a dog manners. He just opens doors by himself. My bad.
You could have old ghetto dog like Brenda 2 or Debo, and they done bit you.
I don't have no dogs bite me. I don't feed dogs that bite me.
I know that's right. They don't bite me, so I'll be honest with you. You know, I pass away. My wife cannot maintain these dogs.
Right.
And it's not that they will even bite her, but they like to jump up on their hind legs. 150-pound dog jump up on his hind legs, as big as you are, I might push you on your butt.
Right.
This is a rough breed, man. Very rough.
Yeah.
I applaud the gentlemen in Pakistan and India who have been breeding these dogs for hundreds of years because they have kept this breed extremely rustic and rough. And for a certain category of people here in the Western Hemisphere, America, primarily like myself, that like rough dogs, this is the breed that you like. It almost reminds me of the Preston Canary Mastiff back in the early 90s and 91. I don't know whether you remember those Prestons that were imported and they hunt, unfortunately, hunted that woman in San Francisco, that jogger. This is a rough breed, man, and that's what I love about it. I just, you know, that's what I want.
Right.
That might not be applicable to everyone else.
Right. So we wouldn't necessarily recommend these dogs for the suburbs or urban living, right?
No, I wouldn't. Now, evidently, you do have people in India and Pakistan who have this breed of dog, and they're in an urban environment. But, I mean, once again, the specimens that I have, no, unequivocally, I would not recommend them. They're not, you have a neighbor next door and that dog comes across the yard or comes into the backyard of your condominium or your townhome. And the dog's gonna fight, man.
Right.
So who's gonna take the lawsuit? Is that what it's gonna be?
Right.
Who's gonna take the lawsuit?
Right. Now, I always try to temper my audience's excitement with the understanding that there are liabilities to having dogs that bite, to having powerful breeds and all that stuff. A lot of folks out there think like, oh, yeah, get the baddest dog and he's going to do the baddest things and you're going to lose your house, homeboy. Yeah, that's what I want to tell you. If you got a house, you're going to lose it. So,
you know what? All right, it's funny because just coming home down the street from my home, and you've been to my house before, a gentleman had two blue heelers, and those blue heelers ran right out in front of my wife's truck. I was driving my wife's truck, and I stopped the court. But the thing about it is, a lot of people forget when you were talking about people wanting to get the baddest breed. A dog has a mind of its own,
right?
And right. Do what you really want to do.
Right. Let me ask you this. So one of the biggest controversies, or not necessarily controversy, one of the things that I noticed in your when we posted your video was some of the people, I believe, some of the Muslims, I'm pretty certain, had issues with the naming of your dogs.
Hamza, correct.
Yeah. So explain that to me.
First of all, I've followed Islam for 50 years. I'm 50 years of age. I was raised Islamically, okay? You cannot be, as you know, my wife is a Muslima, which is a female Muslim, and I'm a Muslim, which is a male follower of Islam. A Muslima is a female follower of Islam. Okay, the people who had the problems with me naming my dog Hamza was the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Hamza reverted, and I reiterate the word reverted, meaning he decided to follow Islam in his 40s. Before, from the age of one when Hamza was born to 40 some years old when he accepted Islam, which is monotheism. That's what the word Islam means. One God, that's it. Hamza was upon paganism. So therefore, Hamza is not an Islamic name. And my proof all lays in the books of Islam, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. That's it. Nothing else legislates or says what is right and wrong in Islam other than the Quran and the Sunnah. That's why when a lot of the people who were making the comment, you can't name a dog Hamza, you would see me say to them, show me the page and the chapter in the Quran or Sunnah that says that. In the Islamic religion, when you implement something that is not said or written down in the Quran and Sunnah, it's called innovation. It actually is against Islam. Okay? You can't mistreat women. That's against Islam. But in regard to the name Hamza, Hamza is not an Islamic name. It is a name of an Arab Muslim who embraced Islam, who was the uncle of the prophet, who was a part of the first generation of Muslims. But it's not an Islamic name, because the only Islamic names, the monotheistic names, are the names of the prophets of God. And that would start with Adam and Eve, Abraham, Isaac, Ezekiel, Moses, Jesus, or Esau for the ones who speak Arabic in Pakistan and India, because I do speak, write, and read Arabic fluently. And then the last name, the prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. All of these people, peace be upon all the prophets, excuse me. All of these people know I could not name a dog after them because they are the highest standards. I couldn't name a dog Jesus because Jesus was spoken to, according to the Christians and the Muslims and the Muslimas, by the angel Jibril through God. So Jesus is one of the highest standings of humankind, mankind. Right. Same thing with the prophet Muhammad. Hamza, actually, in the Islamic culture, was one of the first Islamic warriors to be martyred, killed for protecting Islam. Is he part of the first generation of Islam? Yes, unequivocally he is. But he's not a prophet, first of all. And his name is not an Islamic name, because he was given that name when he did not practice Islam. He was still a pagan. And all of this can be proven in the Quran and the Sunnah. This is not me speaking. This is the words of the Quran and the Sunnah.
Right.
And anyone who says different, I would love for them to, out of all of the people who made comments about me naming the dog Hamza, Hamza definitely is someone who should be respected, the man himself, not his name, and revered, but he is not a prophet. All of those people who made those comments on your page, not one of them have ever posted a chapter or the verse where it says that.
Right.
You have access to your page. I don't.
Right. No. I haven't seen it. But I will just say this. Listen, guys, this is not on your dog channel. Obviously, we have jumped into the realm of spirituality and the faith of Islam. We just got to... A lesson. I knew none of that. I'm not. You know, I did a little bit of reading of the Quran when I was in college, but that's about it for me in Islam.
The thing about it is, you met my father.
Yeah.
Muslim.
Yeah.
Okay. You met my wife. Muslima.
Right.
The only reason that my father, according to the Book of God, the Quran, was allowed to marry the Filipino young lady that you met, Arlene, is because a Muslim can marry a non-Muslim woman as long as she is either chaste, which is a virgin, this is all in the Quran, or she doesn't have children. And Arlene, as you know, is not a Muslima, but right. They don't have children either.
Right.
So, you know, the whole Islamic culture, it's an Islamic culture. It's not a Saudi Arabian culture. It's not a Pakistani culture. It's not an Emirate Arab culture. It is an Islamic culture, because remember, Indonesia and Malaysia are Islamic countries, and those are Asian races.
Right. No doubt. Let's get back to the dogs, man. Back to the dogs. I just wanted to give you an opportunity to address that, because I felt like, there's a lot of people who I feel have incomplete information, and they try to big talk online and stuff. You know, that's, you know, having a channel with 650,000 people on it, sometimes that can get under your skin, right? We need to, at some point we need to listen and be respectful to everybody, and stop thinking that we know everything based on, you know, a 20-minute video, you know what I'm saying, or a 10-minute video, or even this will probably be like an hour-long live.
Just like another comment that I saw, a lot of people don't understand that me being a diamond jeweler, I'm a gemologist. That's what my degree is in, the science of gemstones. I'm a diamond jeweler. I do not want anyone just walking up on my property. So for a person who deals with their material and their line of work that is directly correlated to money, I don't want a very friendly, sociable dog.
Right.
I don't. So, you know, a lot of people think I don't breed these dogs to make money. I sell diamonds to make money. That's my way of living.
Right.
That's how I make money, period. So, you know, just let that be known. That is my profession. Not breeding dogs.
Right.
Period. Okay. Now, Donald Stark's profession is breeding dogs. He has a lot of different breeds of dogs. That's what he does for a living. One of them.
Right.
There's a couple different professions. So, but yeah, any questions? I would love to respectfully answer any questions from any of your of the followers of your page. Because
okay, well, that's what we have right now. We're about 30 minutes into this video, and guys, if you're watching this video, in the description of the video, there's a link. If you want to call into the show, ask Mr. Evans any questions. This is your time to do that. Just click the link from a cell phone, your computer, your laptop, whatever. You'll dial directly into the show. That's a pretty easy process, right? Getting onto the show.
Yeah. And I'm not that tech savvy either.
Very cool. So while we wait on some other calls, let's talk about the fact that you know the Bully Kutta is not your first breed. You started back in the 80s, 90s.
Been around dogs all my life.
Right. So what were some of the breeds you had before you got into the Bully Kutta?
My father, when he was a air policeman in the Air Force, and when he was with the Secret Service, the Special Services Division, Alfred Evans is his name, he and my mother, Siney Evans, who actually taught at your alma mater, she taught at Howard University, they had, as a child, I had Dobermans, German Shepherds, Malinois. Once I was able to obtain my own dogs, the first dog I had, of course, you already know, Pitbull.
Yeah, everybody started with Pitbull.
Definitely have a decent number of game Pitbulls. I've posted pictures on my Facebook and Instagram page of me dealing with the Neapolitan Mastiff back in the late 80s, early 90s. I've also owned a couple Preston Canary Mastiffs. And then, of course, the Borable was the most amount of dogs, or the highest amount of dogs, number-wise. Because I had about 14 Borables. And then, and I was getting them from Lucas Van Buren. I had the Dopper Bloodline Borables, South African Mastiffs, the Tovic Bloodline. All of these are imported from South Africa. And I also had the Spitzfur Bloodline from Lucas Van Buren at Spitzfur Kennels. And then when I was able to, I decided to get the Bully Kutta, the Pakistani and Indian Master.
Okay. All right. We got a call. We're coming in. This is Muhammad. How's it going, my brother?
How you doing, man?
Excellent.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Hey, Muhammad, how you doing, baby? Are you listening?
Yes, sir.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Brother. I just want to say, first of all, man, I love your show, man. I've been watching you for a long, long time, man. And you are definitely connecting me with a lot of dogs.
All right. I appreciate that, man.
Yeah, I got a couple questions, man. The first one, I know, just since we kind of touched on religion, it's not really about religion, it's about dogs. Is that I've always wanted a dog as a kid, but I've kind of been, you know, just the religion kind of talks about a certain aspect of how to have a dog. I wanted you to kind of touch on that, on how to, is it, you know, how to raise a dog as a Muslim, you know, but really just, I don't know if that's kind of going off basic. I just wanted to kind of get some information on that.
No,
if it is, I have other questions. I have other questions related about dogs also that I can go into.
Okay, listen, let me get you. Give me. Okay, so basically, that question is how to raise a dog within the context of the Islamic faith. What's your, I'm gonna get your second question. Give me 1 second, Aaron. I'm gonna get your second question because your audio is a little messed up. Then I'm gonna, what's your second question?
The second question is, you mentioned several dogs that you had that I really love. You know, I'm looking at, you mentioned that you had a Borbo, and I don't know if you said Rottweiler tonight. I wanted to ask, you know, what was your difference between a Borbo and a Bully Kutta? Because, you know, I kind of really looked at the dogs and even looked at, you know, Zeke's videos, and I like the dog, but if I'm being honest, sometimes the aesthetic of it kind of throws me off a little bit. And sometimes they can be too aggressive, at least from the information I've had. And I'm kind of leaning towards a Borbo than a Bully Kutta. So I wanted to kind of touch on that. What, you know, when you had Borbo, what did you enjoy on it? And also why you ended up choosing a Bully Kutta.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks a lot, Muhammad. Let me, then I'm answer those questions for you. All right.
Appreciate it.
All right. Thanks for calling in, bro. Okay.
The first question I'm going to answer is the difference between the Borbo and the Bully Kutta. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, Bully Kutta. Okay, the Borbo, of course, was a breed that was created to guard livestock. So they're much, much more adaptable to being around passive animals, like geese, like lamb. I have had Borbos where they established a pack order, meaning they had to, you know, establish a pack order. You have to do it in a violent nature. They fought and they had a pack leader. And the way that occurred is I had about 3 or 4 Borbos out in the yard at the same time. Okay. The Borbos are much, much more acclimated to being around wife and children. They're not always trying to display dominance. Okay. Now, for someone who has, let's say hypothetically, a cat in their home, a wife, and 2 small children, then the Borbo would be a better guard dog because they're not just going to let a stranger walk up on your property without greeting that stranger. They may greet it with a bark, they may greet it with a growl, and they'll stand their ground. Once you try to intrude past the dog, then they will bite you unequivocally. Will bite you, okay? Versus the Bully Kutta. From the time that you arrived at my home, Hamza and Brenda were trying to bite you. Brenda was actually biting on the chain to get off the chain to bite you. There is no, because this is a breed that is genetically made by God, as well as genetically manufactured, or I'm saying, as a matter of fact, but bred, genetically bred to fight and hunt, their prey drive is just high. They know that I'm the alpha pack leader, and they're going to follow in suit. They know that's why you see their chains of position where they can't get to each other, because they get to each other, they're going to fight, plain and simple. Male and female, mother and daughter, father and son. Doesn't matter. They're going to fight. And I don't know whether you noticed, but in the video, you consistently see them and other videos of other people and their dogs. The Bully Kutta is always jumping up, standing up. That's a sign of dominance. It's just that you met me. I'm 5'11", 265. I'm not a small man. And I'm a very physically strong man, but those dogs have jumped up and tried to stand on my wife's shoulder, and they almost knocked on that beautiful behind that God gave them, period, point blank. So this is the Bully Kutta is an aggressive breed. And remember, because of my mother and the way I was raised, I use words in context. I don't use words out of context. The Borbo is a very defensive breed. A police officer is defensive. A hitman is aggressive.
Right.
So that's giving Muhammad, God willing, I've given him the difference. It's just him and maybe his brother, and he may want to have a Bully Kutta. But it's him and his wife and his children, he may want to get a Borbo.
Okay.
Now, in regard to the second or the first question, which to me is the most important question, how to own a dog in the Islamic culture, Islamically correct. The way that you can own a dog, the way that you can own a dog in the Islamic culture is stated in this book right here. Okay, this is called the Sunnah. You cannot have a dog Islamically in your house because, as you see, when you visited my home, we pray on the floor. Okay, for the Christian culture, the church is kept clean. The mosque for the Islamic culture is kept clean. For the Jewish culture, the temple is kept clean. The floors are kept clean. Unfortunately, in the Islamic culture, well, not unfortunately, but in the Islamic culture, we cannot have the dogs in the house because the female dog will menstruate, which makes the floors dirty that we're praying on, and the male dog will excrete semen, which makes the floors dirty. And actually, we all know this, who, for people like you and myself who actually own dogs. Dogs go outside and they dig in the dirt. They roll around in the ground. I mean, you know, I love them. It's evident I love my dogs, man. I feed them better than some humans eat. But are they dirty in regard to human standards? Unequivocally, they are. They're dirty. So for a person who follows Islam, for the Islamic culture, because we pray in our homes on the floor when we're offering salat, prayer, which is the word salat in Arabic. You can't have the dogs in the house. This is why you see the setup that I have for my dogs. They have their own house. They have their own cages. They can exit their cages on the chains. I can give it a 20-foot chain, or thanks to God giving me the amount of property I have, I can give it a 300-foot chain. Doesn't matter. So Islamically correct, and that's why it went black. My computer screen that's why. See, I have both my screens on. Okay. I was working before you called. Islamically, we can have the dogs outside. Islamically, we must feed and care and medicate the dogs correctly so that they're comfortable. We must treat them like they are a four-legged family member because that is what they are. Period.
Right.
So, but can we have them in the house?
Aaron, you froze up on me. Give me one. Aaron, are you there? You froze up on
me. Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. I didn't hear that last part. Here.
You would have to be able to make sure the dog wouldn't touch the floors.
Right.
In the house that you're praying in.
I got you.
So that's virtually impossible.
Okay. We got one more. We got another call coming in from Debo. Let's bring, I believe that's a woman. Or that's a dude. I'm sorry. What's going on, my man? How's it going?
Assalamualaikum. Salute. Salute.
Alaikum salam. Rahmatullahi barakatuh. What's up, I?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I just had a quick question, man. What are your thoughts on the Gold Tur and the Gold Dong dogs out of Pakistan?
Because I've never owned them, I couldn't honestly give you an opinion on them because I've never owned them. But to my knowledge, to the people that I have spoken with who do own them, the Gold Dong is the Pakistani bulldog. So just like the American Bulldog, it has a high threshold for pain, first of all. Because, you know, the American Bulldog gets kicked by the bulls because that's what they're created for, to herd the cow. And the Gold Dong is very, very aggressive, like the Bully Kutta is, meaning they like to fight. They like to attack. Same thing with the Gold Dong Terrier. That being a terrier, of course, like the Pit Bull Terrier, it's a smaller breed of dog. Because terriers are smaller, and it would be similar to what we have over here, the pit bull terrier. They like to fight, and they have a high threshold for pain. So what I have noticed in Pakistan and India with the Gold Dong Terrier, primarily in Pakistan, for people who may have an apartment or a townhome or something that doesn't have a lot of yard, the Gold Dong Terrier serves as a good guard dog. Because it's small. But once again, I cannot give a definitive answer on it because I've never owned them. So for me to give a supposed to be definitive, educated answer on the Gold Dung Terrier or the Gold Dung, that would be a lot, man. I ain't owned them, though. So how I'm going to give you, see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. And I just had one more question. Are there any books or any material on the Bully Kutta that we can get?
Actually, that is what the gentleman, Donald Stocks, Mohan Kumar in India, and Zarmid Aziz in Pakistan, as well as he also is in Great Britain working on his doctorate degree, Muslim. We're actually trying to work to formulate some form of literature. Because unfortunately, like I said in the initial video that Zeke did at my home, not having literature on this breed, not having any form of written proof, where there's no written proof, there's no truth. Unless you go with that theory, then don't go to a doctor or a dentist or obtain a lawyer. Because all these people go through books. So no, there's no real written information on the breed at all. But God willing, between those four good men and myself, we are trying to compile some written literature, primarily on the mentality of the dog, the size prerequisite of the dog. I'm not going to go into the history of the breed because there's a lot of politics involved with the history between Pakistan and India. Both of them want to claim ownership of the breed, and the breed was around before both of these countries were established. Okay. Pakistan and India.
Yes, sir.
All right, Debo, I'm going to go on to the next call, bro. Thanks for calling in, man.
All right. Thank you, brothers.
All right, thank you, man.
Awesome.
All right, well, next, I think I believe that you pronounce this Zek. We'll see. What's going on, my man? How's it going?
What's up, man? How's it going, man?
Excellent.
Well, I just had two quick questions. I'm going to step outside. I was wanted to ask a question. So my first question is, can you see me?
You're frozen, but we can hear you. So go ahead and tell us.
All right, my first, yeah, but I got to show you. I might have to just get off and get back on. I don't know why it's frozen. If you think there's anything I can...
there you go. Oh, you froze.
You see me now?
I see you now. I see another frozen frame.
All right, well, just bring me on after the next call.
Okay, I'm going to get the next call.
So I'll try to figure this out.
Okay. All right. We got one more. We got Roderick. Let's get Roderick in there.
He sees you. He whines on you.
Hello, Roderick.
How you doing, sirs? Can you hear me?
I can hear you good.
Thank you for having me on your show. I appreciate you both, and I enjoy both of your content. I only got one question for you. So I have a German Shepherd. You know, he's a high-ranked drive dog. So what I wanted to ask is, how does the Bully Kutta compare with, would that be a good second dog, or is that a dog that isn't for the novice?
Obviously, you have a male or female German Shepherd.
I have a male.
Okay, so I would only recommend maybe, and I do reiterate the word maybe, getting a female Bully Kutta. Because of the gender difference, there's already some form of a pack order established. But you get a female like what I have on my yard, the female Howley and the female Brenda too. They gonna test that male. He gonna have to prove the fact he's the alpha of the pack. You do know how that happens, right?
Yeah, I do. That's the one thing that's a little bit scary with having a dog of that nature. Now, I don't find nothing wrong with that kind of dog because I know every dog has his purpose. So, but when it comes to the dynamics between the two of them, that's the thing that worries me. So that would be a dog that is made for one dog in the household, basically.
I wouldn't
recommend it, bro. I don't know a whole lot about a whole lot, but just understanding the Bully Kutta and the German Shepherd. I think if you got German Shepherds, you need to find something that's going to work with a German Shepherd, bro. I wouldn't go with Bully Kutta.
Malinois.
Yeah, you're in the, you know, it's like, It's like if you got a fleet of cars and you started with pickup trucks, you know, now you're trying to throw a Corvette. It's like, dude, what you doing? You know, you got a family of 10. You can't get a two-seater. So I would recommend something else. And I'm just, that's just me being trying to be helpful.
Hey, listen, I appreciate it because I would have went out here.
I wouldn't recommend it. You know, it's just that I listen to what you say and you say in the house. My dogs are outside right now. Mm-hmm. They can't get to each other. They're not in the house. But provided they could get to each other, they'd be outside fighting.
Yeah.
So I'm going to stick with Zeke, man. Just breathe easy and get you another breed other than this, man. Yeah. Or just get only this breed. That's it.
All right. Well, my last question would be, in regards to rank drive, do you have to deal with that, especially because the dog is so physically strong? I'm only 5'8". So how would I be able to contend with such an animal?
I'm going to be 100% honest with you, Slim. I've never heard that term, rank drive. I've heard prey drive. I've heard alpha syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Rank drive may be something that's applicable to the shits in arena, which, of course, I do have knowledge of because my father had German Shepherds when he was in the Secret Service in the Air Force. But, I don't know what that term means, so I'm not going to say yes or no. I don't know what that term means.
All right, if you don't mind, just for a little context. So that kind of drive would be, for example, if I go and the dog does something, I tell him not to, and I reprimand the dog. And the dog will go and growl at me, or the dog will go and come for me and redirect his aggression back onto the handler because he's like, you don't get to pop me. You don't get to tell me what to do, you know? So something in that nature.
Well, see, you're saying handler, so therefore you're speaking once again of that personal protection type of arena, okay? I'm the alpha of my dog. Because just like I'm the alpha of these acres I live on, either you got to martyr me or I'm going to dog you, period. Okay? My dog's going to do what I ask them to do. I'm not going to abuse them. But number one, I can outthink them, first of all. And number two, they're going to do what I ask them to do. But provided you came to my property, before you walk up on my acres, I'm going to tell you, young man, you get near that dog, it's going to attack you, and I cannot get it off you. I'm 265 pounds, 5'11". I'm a big man. I have a little bit of fat on me, but I cannot get this 160-pound, 170-pound dog off of you. So stay away from the dog. But it's going to attack you unequivocally.
All right. All right. Well, thank you for your time, gentlemen. I appreciate it greatly.
You're welcome.
All right. Thanks a lot, sir. Talk to you in a bit. You're welcome. All right, bro. All right, let's try to get Zach back on here. I think it looks like he's moving around a little bit. There you go. What's up, bro?
Yo. What's up, man? Can you see me now?
Yep.
All right. My first question was, so I'm going to show you my yard real quick. I don't know if I can flip the camera. I ain't even going to try.
Nice yard.
So can y'all see the yard?
Yep.
Yeah.
So I was going to ask you, what would you suggest I do? I got another kennel. And I was going to build another wood deck. I want to do a 10x10 because I got a female. She in heat, so she in the kennel in the house right now. But I wanted to do a 10x10. Would you suggest I do another one on a wood deck or do, like, concrete, not a slab, but, like, you know, you could buy, like, the squares from, like, Home Depot?
Mm-hmm.
Would you suggest I do that on the ground or just do another deck to keep them off the dirt and everything?
If you're asking me, I like the wood deck. I like the softer surface. I like the elevated away from the whatever could be on the ground.
Yep.
I mean, it's probably a little bit more expensive and probably not as durable. But if you can afford it and you can build it yourself, man, I would go with that.
All right.
I'm in agreement with that. And to be honest with you, first of all, that's a nice setup that you have. But you saw that dog just jumped on the house. I would recommend putting a roof on top of that cage because they can jump out that cage. Okay.
Yeah,
The thing about putting it on concrete, young man, is you don't walk on concrete all day long.
Right.
Why would you want the dog to? It's going to affect their joints. It's bad for their hips. Okay. Wood does have some form of flexibility, first of all. And second of all, you don't want it on the ground because, like on Zeke's video, when he first initially came to our state, my wife and my home, a lot of people were like, why don't you just put a fence up around your property? And you do understand that dogs can dig, right?
Yeah.
They can dig right under that fence. And dogs can jump. So the setup that you have for that dog right there is the ideal setup. That's my opinion.
All right, yeah. All right,
put so a roof on it, though. Put a roof on it, and then it'd be ideal.
Yeah, I know. I gotta get one up. Right. he just turned a year, man. But he can jump. Right, he just don't know.
Scale that fence with no problem, Slim. Don't get it confused.
Yeah, man.
It's a good looking dog too.
Yeah. I remember you did the documentary on APBTs. His grandsire is actually LT Touré. That dog you had up there on that documentary.
Okay.
And then my second question was. I had a question I really wanted to ask. I can't even remember. So I just asked this. In terms of like training a game bred dog, like how trained do you believe they could actually get?
You can handle that because the game dogs I had, I used them for the un-Islamically correct reason of fighting. That's what I had them for and that's what I used them for. So it won't no training.
I mean, honestly, bro, like, listen, the volatility and like game is a game. When someone says a game dog, that's a spectrum. To be honest with you, dogs are extremely game and bred to be really game. They're fighting as puppies. Those dogs might be very hard to train, and I wouldn't even say train. Like train in terms of obedience, doing what you said, that's fine. They're gonna be easy to live with people. The if you're talking about training them not to fight or training them not to
not that at all. I'm just saying like simple things like just little like sitting all that simple stuff. He'll do it, but he be just getting hard head sometimes and won't listen. Like unless I got a treat, he not trying to work. If I put him in a spring pole or anything like that or get him to run, he'll do that all day. But just simple things sometimes I be wanting him to do. And I know in reality what I got. So right.
Game dogs shouldn't necessarily be any harder to the thing with game dogs is the one thing that you're gonna me personally, like I said, I don't really deal with a lot of game dogs. I did a video a little while ago with Larry Hansen. She trains American Pit Bull Terriers from working blood, but I wouldn't necessarily call her dogs like highly game. So that's a different thing. But most game dogs are really compliant in terms of dealing with human interaction. Like they'll listen. They're easy to listen to. The hard thing is that if they get engaged in a fight, if they get engaged and if their prey drive gets activated, it's hard to turn them off. And that's usually the biggest problem with game dogs.
I definitely experienced that, man. I was walking one day and the dog got loose and he turned to a whole nother person. But thank you, man. I appreciate y'all. All right, man.
All right, take it easy. All right, we're going to go to Rodney. How's it going, man?
Hey, I'm all right. How you doing, man?
Oh, excellent, my brother. How you doing?
That's good. What's up, man? We was up Buckner together. I had long hair, though. You can't. What's going on? We used to talk about dogs all day. Yeah, man. Like the guy a minute ago, I saw you on your last video. I tried to get in touch with you. So when you get off this video, I'm at Uari Bulbles. Uari Bulbles on Instagram. Right.
Just give me your phone number, Slim. Give me, or I can give you my phone number.
Okay, go ahead. You guys want? You want? Listen, why don't you give me your Instagram so we're not putting phone numbers out over the line?
Yeah.
All right, go to
Uari Bulbles.
Spell it for
U-W-H. Me. U-W-H-A-R-R-I-E Bulbles.
U-W-H. Finish spelling it for me.
U-W-H-A-R-R-I-E. Like Uari Mountains in North Carolina. Uari Bulbles. Yeah, he hit me on that. I was looking at a Bully Kutta. That's why I was trying to get in touch with you to get a little bit more information on. Because I've been dealing with guardian breeds, raising and training guardian breeds. English Mastiff. I left English Mastiff because they started getting too too big. They not like my old English Mastiffs of the 90s. They not even like that no more. I went to Corso, Italian Mastiff. Even they've changed. They're not the same dog from some years ago. You find very few that are. And it's some guys that got some, but they so hard to deal with. Right now, the dog game, to me, to be honest, the dog game is worse than the dope game out here. People don't be honest, and they just breeding for... is everything is a fad. You get very few, that really like and really like dogs, and the guy that just left with the game dog. I grew up training game dogs. When I grew up, my dad had like 50 game dogs. We would have 2-3 litters at a time. I always wanted other dogs, but we had 50-60 dogs. My pops used to be like, man, you got a yard full of dogs. I'm not buying a German Shepherd or a Labrador. But I done had probably every dog across the board you can think of. Hybrid wolves. American Pit Bull Terrier, I just went back to in the last probably year.
My aspect on dogs is every dog is created for a reason.
Okay? That's right.
Certain dogs are not going to be compatible for certain environments.
That's right.
Okay.
That's 100% right.
So, and in regard to the dog game, everything that entails money is a business. Period.
Yes.
So when you are breeding dogs as a business, which I do not do, you have to give out first, you have to produce the healthiest specimen.
That's correct.
Hopefully mandatory. Second, you have to have some form of knowledge behind the
breed. That's correct. Yep.
To solidify the validity of your specimen of the dog.
Uh-huh.
Like I said, my profession is a diamond dealer. I have a degree in gemology.
Yeah, yeah.
All the diamonds I sell, they have paperwork to prove what they are. There's a definitive science that proves it. With dogs, it's virtually impossible. You just mentioned the hybrid wolf. Now you're mixing a dog with a non-domesticated animal. It's just...
Mm-hmm. No. My point for mentioning the hybrid wolf is because I understand the change in a lot of the dogs out here now. No matter the breed, a lot of them have changed because I was getting ready to make a point. The reason why I went back to the American Pit Bull Terrier is because I've been personally breeding and training myself, not selling, but personally, and I purchased different animals and different breeds from other breeders, and that's why I made the analogy with the drug game, because just like you said, you need healthy individuals. Healthy, they were created for a reason. That's not out here. It's getting harder and harder to find. They'll look like them. I've been getting guardian breeds, spending $3,000-$4,000 on guardian breeds, and they don't even guard. They won't even guard. I mean, no guarding instinct because they breed in pedigree to pedigree. This champion from Africa, I just had the Bulbuls. Now my Bulbul Max, he had a heat stroke. I lost him last summer. That's why I didn't go back, because it's every breeder had issues. I don't care what it is, it'll be some issues. But a lot of breed, man, we never went to the vet like you go to the vet now. We never went to a vet. It had to be a really extreme, because we knew how to take care of them. We were close to vets. I was taught by a vet when I was younger so that he didn't have to come out every time something would go wrong, because I showed and raised horses too, Tennessee Walkers and straight Egyptian Sheikh Bay Arabians. So I grew up in the country around dogs and training them. And in the past, I say the past, I've completely left, and I'm gonna breed some band dogs because I know what I want in a dog. But what's happening right now? It's getting hard to find good specimens to breed, and it's people that have them. But a lot of people that have really good, everybody you see with a nice Instagram page and $5,000-$6,000 dogs, it don't mean they be good. It don't even mean that they still carrying some of the traits they were bred for. And that's the issue I had been running into. That's why I hadn't been switching. That's why I hadn't went back to the Bourbon. Okay. I like them. I like the one I had. But I think that the American Pit Bull Terrier, in my experience right now, outside of some breeds that I hadn't had, is still doing and performing the same way it did when I was 10, 12, 15, 16 years old. Exact same.
Okay, Roddy, I'm going to go ahead and stop you. I got some other people waiting, man. I do appreciate your input.
Okay.
No problem. Share your thoughts with you.
Well, I hit you on Instagram,
son. Hit me up on Instagram.
All right, guys. Let's get to, we got,
yep.
All right. Thanks a lot, Roddy.
All right, appreciate it.
All right. I got Aditya. Let me see. Let me go have a pronounce his name for us. What's going on, my man? How you pronounce your name?
Aditya.
Okay.
Aditya.
Aditya.
Yeah.
Are you Muslim, guys?
Sorry, actually, I'm... Huh?
He asked where you Muslim.
What's your question, sir?
Sir, actually, you told that you are breeding the Bully Kutta. So I thought, can I just ask you the bloodline, because I am in India only. So, I wanted to get information, and, because I'm just in an urban area, and I wanted to get the information about Bully Kutta.
The bloodlines that I have.
And the bloodlines you have.
I can't see. You want me to ask the question, sir?
Okay, yes, sir. You talk about the bloodlines.
I have Blade, Pakistani import. That's the grandfather.
Oh.
I have Black Jack, the Pakistani import to India. I have Emily, the Pakistani import. And yes. I also have Tank, the Pakistani import as well.
Now, can you suggest a breeder in India?
Hold on, sir. Those are.
And sir, can you suggest a breeder in India?
Okay, Aditya, I got your last question. I'm gonna ask him for you. And thanks for calling in, bro. We just having a whole lot of confusion, but I'll ask him your question. All right. Thanks for calling. His last question was, could you suggest a breeder in India?
Yes, Mohan Kumar.
Okay.
His name on Facebook is Sono Lativol.
Okay. All right. We got one more call. I'm going to take one more call before we get out of here. This is Harmon. How's it going, Harmon?
Hey, I'm doing good, Zeke. How are you guys doing? Thank you very much.
Excellent, my brother.
How you doing, man? Fine.
I'm doing good. Thank you very much, sir. A lot of good information you were dropping. I just got a question that was sparked by the caller a couple of calls ago, Rodney. He was talking about not going to the vets and, you know, not getting your dogs vaccinated and whatnot. Since you own this...
Just for a quick correction. I don't necessarily say that he did not get your dogs vaccinated. I think what he was saying is that he had a
You're
relationship
right.
with the vets where he was able to do a lot of that stuff himself, as opposed to running to the vet every time he needed something done.
Gotcha. I was curious, though, since you own a breed that's so rugged, you know, I'm sure people in India and Pakistan, they don't really get their dogs vaccinated. I would bet my money on that. Do you get your dogs vaccinated since they are such a hardy breed?
Unequivocally, I do.
Okay.
All of my dogs have their rabies shots. Actually, since the interview that Zeke and I had when he came to my home, the dog Hamza passed away, and he was the first dog to go to the Colorado State University, the third best veterinarian school in America, to have a necropsy performed on him to determine his cause of death. I'm a firm believer in science. I'm a firm believer in education, knowledge. You can't read it. It doesn't exist. With the only one exception is that there's only one God, and that God doesn't have to prove himself. Other than that, everything that you can find can be found in a book. Provided my dogs, honestly, they don't get any, thanks to God and God alone, they don't get any skin irritations on a weekly basis, because they will kennel fight. They will have sores and be bleeding out. I'll feed my dogs and come outside later on that night to switch them around, and they've been fighting because the food was in the cages. So therefore, they're not fighting with each other because they can't touch one another. But through the kennel fence, their face pressing against those hard metal fences so hard that there may be blood in the buckets of water. Little blood, not a lot. I mean, the prey drive is very high. But yes, unequivocally, I'm a firm believer in veterinarian care, because they're my four-legged family members. That'd okay. be like my child or my wife being sick and me saying, no, don't go to a hospital. You can't straddle the line when it comes to veterinarian care. And that's why I said the gentleman who was just on the call who said he doesn't use the veterinarians, I don't think he was saying he doesn't believe in veterinarians. But prime example, he has the type of breed of dogs where they might get a cut on their face, or they might have gotten into a conflict with another dog. You know, you don't have to take the dog to the veterinarian unless you've hit a bleeder artery. The dog is not bleeding. It may have blood from the skin being pierced, but you simply put hydrogen peroxide on it. You simply put iodine on it, and you make sure that the dog stays separate. You know that they're going to be swollen in the face from them fighting each other. And then you may, and I reiterate the word may, want to give them some form of antibiotics, but you may not. It depends on the russicness and roughness of the breed. A dog like a German Shepherd does not have a high threshold for pain. They weren't created for fighting and hunting. That's why their last name is Shepherd, German Shepherd. They're herding dogs. The Bully Kutta, the American Bulldog, the Pit Bull Terrier, these dogs have high threshold for pains, and they were created for one purpose: fighting. So they don't damage easily. So yes, unequivocally, I believe in veterinary care.
I think Harmon has frozen though. Harmon, yeah.
Pull right up. I see. So yeah, I definitely believe in veterinary care.
Okay, Harmon, are you still with us, or are you froze? Okay, he's froze up. All right, let me get. Okay. All right, so that's cool. Thanks a lot for the call, Harmon. I appreciate you calling in, bro. All right, man. Well, we're going to wrap this up, man. I got a birthday party to get to, and then a couple of basketball games. My son is hooping today. So I'm excited.
I have dog duty.
Huh?
I have dog duty, baby. You've been to my home. You know what it is.
Yeah.
I have to go out there with that snow shovel and scoop up all that defecation and all those cages. And I've reverted my dogs back to a chicken and egg diet. So boiled eggs and boiled chicken.
Okay.
That's it.
All right. Hey, man, well, I want to thank you as always. I appreciate you coming on and talking to the people, opening your yard up to me.
And you do a great service to the animal or dog lovers abroad, because you're bringing reliable, foundated information that people need. Plain right. and simple.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Welcome, I'll holler at you later on, Z.
Yes, sir. Have a great day, man.
You too.
Enjoy that work.
Yeah. Always.
All right. Hey, guys, that's it. That's going to be the end of the show. I want to thank you all who stuck in there, gave a lot of, had a lot of good calls, a lot of good, good conversation, great conversation. I do believe that the Bully Kutta is not a dog for everybody. I know you guys, there's a lot of fascination with the breed out there. If you're interested, I think it's for a very specific lifestyle and for a very specific purpose. If you're going to get this breed, I would not, like the guy said, he had a German Shepherd. I just wouldn't. And like I said, I'm not an expert. And it doesn't mean, listen, when I say I wouldn't do something, it doesn't mean that it can't be done, right? Like, I wouldn't try to dunk from the free throw line, even though some people can do it. I don't think it's for most of us. So we just have to kind of keep that in mind. And we own dogs and we want to have dogs, especially breeds that are powerful, breeds that come with a certain level of bad PR. We want to always, as dog people, dog lovers, shine the best light on the breeds that we own. So we always want to set our dogs up and our breeds up for success. We don't want to bring a dog into a family or a situation or a community where they're not likely to succeed, and the breed's reputation gets damaged, our personal reputation gets damaged, our bank accounts become damaged from just making a bad decision. So, again, if you are interested in the Bully Kutta, I would suggest you have a very specific lifestyle, have a lot of space, a lot of land, not a lot of neighbors, hopefully you get the dog and you enjoy it, and it's the best thing for you. But like I said, it's not for everyone. It's not for most people. All right, guys. Before we go, I want to thank I believe that's Zachariah for the super chat. I appreciate you, brother. Thanks for that. I'm going to chat you out real quick. All super chats are appreciated. Actually, and if you really guys really want to get jumping, super chat me up, man, because right now things are opening up. I'm going to try to spend some money, and the more money I have to spend to travel, I'm going to do that to make some videos. I'm looking to get a Fila video done, and there are definitely no Fila breeders close to me that I can work with, I think. So I'm going to have to do some traveling. But we want to, jumpstart this channel again. 2020 took a toll on me in terms of, getting out and getting what I call signature videos for this channel. So we're going to be doing that, or I'll be doing that this year. All right, guys, thanks again for watching. If you're watching right now, please have a wonderful day. It's a Saturday. It's a weekend. If you get the day off, do something productive, constructive. If you have a dog, do something with your dog, and have a wonderful, wonderful day. All right, guys, peace.